think of all my faults and my failures. When I consider all the times I've let God down, I am humbled by the grace He has extended. I'm amazed at the mercy I have found. I could never earn His love on my own, yet every time I come before His throne,
my soul redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, my soul redeemed before the great I am. When He looks at me, He sees the nails are red.
And all that I
can be, I stand redeemed.
Even at my best, I am unworthy. Precious gift to Him. The bitter mark of sin will never fade away, but I can come before Him unashamed.
My sin redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. My sin redeemed before the great I am.
As we stand, first and last.
All right, let's welcome our visitors tonight. Please welcome our visitors. glad to be in church tonight. Say amen. We're glad you're here, and we appreciate each and every one of you being in attendance on this Sunday night. And we want to welcome John and Sue Gordon from Gaffney, South Carolina, and said, how did you hear about us? And it said, from everyone. That's great. God bless you. We're glad you're here. We love visitors. Somebody say amen. We love visitors. We appreciate you being here. God bless you very much. Brother, God bless you. Should remember your name. Tell me your name. Yeah, Brother Jimmy Surratt. Yes, sir. Thank you for being here. All of our visitors, God bless you. All of our members, we appreciate you being here. I think this week has become like notorious for vacation, so we probably got 30 or more gone on vacation, but nonetheless, we're glad you're back in. And we got a long list of folks on the prayer list. I want you to remember them. I want to add Miss Cindy Bishop, all right? We didn't put that in the bulletin, but I spoke to Brother Barry a little while ago. And so, and also Miss Michelle Jimenez and also Chris Thomas. All this has happened through the day. And my wife's not here, but she's not well with her leg. Pray for her and others. And she'll be going with me up to Chad Benefield's. Pray for us. We'll leave tomorrow. Be gone Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday to preach up there at Victory Baptist Church in Roxboro, North Carolina. You remember us in prayer as we endeavor to try to be a blessing to that church, all right? And again, we thank the Lord for saving a little Layla this morning. That's the greatest thing in all the world. We give God the glory for that. Let's have the ushers come on in. We'll get the regular tithe and the regular offering. And I want Brother Spencer to come up here. Let's drum up a little support for tomorrow night. Tell them where you're going. I've got it right here. Let's see. I've got it right here. If you want to drum up a little support, tell them what time you're leaving.
All right. We're going to leave here about 5:40 tomorrow. The reason we're leaving so early, they start at 7. The computer says hour and 10-minute drive. So with the highway conditions, we want to make sure we get there in time for the service. So we're leaving at 5:40. If you'd like to ride, we'll take the van. If we don't have enough, we'll just jump in my truck and take off down there. But Brother Tony Hudson, we love him.
Yes.
You don't hear of him in this area much anymore. Nobody can take that kind of preaching anymore. Yep. So it'll be a blessing, I promise you, to go down there and hear him tomorrow night. So if you'd like to go, 5:40, be leaving and going down to Cannon Mountain Baptist Church in Pickens, South Carolina, hear Brother Tony Hudson. We love him. Looking forward to it.
Yes, sir. God bless you. Victoria, stop right there, Victoria. Show him that pretty baby, all right? God bless your heart. You can go on now. Go on now. Don't let that baby start crying. Amen. God bless you. All right. Brother Todd, step up here and pray for us. Well, yeah, we're going to get the offering, aren't we? No, hold it. We'll get it right. Y'all go ahead and take the offering, and then we'll get Brother Todd to pray for us. All right, go ahead and pray for us. Judy Stoltz needs prayer. We have Brother and Sister Rochester needs prayer. We have Josh Spencer needs prayer. We have Brandon and Daphne needs prayer. All of them just finding out. These folks are not well. Folks are getting sick. Not sure what it is, but pray God will help each and every one of them. And Brother Todd, I praise the Lord. Maybe what, a year and a half ago?
November
of 2020? Mm-hmm. 2020. He told me, he said, I thought I was leaving here. And you know what? I thought he's leaving here too. But I'm so glad God spared him. I mean that. I'm so glad God touched our brother right up there in that hospital all by himself. And I'm so glad the Lord took care of you. Amen. Pray for us, all right, please, sir.
Father, we thank you for another opportunity to come to your house, Lord. Thank you for all you mean to bless us. Thank you for what you've done in my life, my family. Thank you for this church family, Lord. We ask your blessings on this offering. Be with the remainder of the service. Be with the preacher as he preaches. All the singing, musicians, everybody touches the service. Your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, this is Brother Jimmy Owens and the boys, and they're going to sing one for us. We'll have one more. Then we'll get into the Word of God, the Lord willing. All right?
Such disgrace on the old rugged cross. He took my place. No greater love than that of Calvary. Disgrace on the old rugged cross, he took my place. No greater love than that of Calvary. No greater love than that of Calvary.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate Brother David always getting these microphones ready for us immediately after the service tonight. 10 and up, 8 and up. I've already heard a couple 8-year-olds going over, and Brother Nathan and Ashley's fine with that. And they're going to the fellowship hall. They'll have hot dogs, the trimmings, and snacks, and other things, and then maybe a few games, maybe go to the other end a little bit. But your young people, your teenagers, your young adults, even, you're more than welcome to stay after the service tonight. And thank you all for being willing to take time out of your life to help these young people and to socialize with them. I think there's strength in numbers, amen? There's strength in numbers. So you young people stay together, enjoy the good time. The food's free, it won't cost you a dime, and you'll enjoy it. All right, y'all ladies ready? Come on.
To the sky. creation, he already knew. He loved me in spite of what I do. And to think that the same God in heaven would come and inhabit our praise. I am humbled by the thought he really loves me so much. On Calvary took my place, and he knows the heavy burdens that we carry, and he bottles every tear. The one who calls the stars
Thank you, ladies. I appreciate it. Never heard that song, I don't believe it. Very good. Appreciate it very, very much. Also want to remember tonight, Miss Connie Biggerstaff, as she heals and gets better, okay? Take your Bibles, everybody, and go to Philippians chapter 1. Please, tonight, something brand new from God's Word. Well, there's nothing new under the sun, but, excuse me, but new as far as what the preacher prepares for and studies and brings to the people. Okay, I appreciate all of you being here. Again, we appreciate our visitors being here. Next Sunday, we're going to the fellowship hall. We trust and pray you'll pack a well-filled basket and enjoy the good time of fellowship. And again, I'm looking forward. I'm not sure actually who they always have, but I'm sure, well, I'll tell you this, they've always had great men in, amen. Always had great men in, and so we're looking for that next Sunday morning and Sunday night, the Lord willing. Now, before I preach tonight, and this is part of the message, by the way, I want you to listen close, and I want to give you some information, okay, about your Bible, and you should know this. Most of you do know this, and so in our Bible, how our Bible is put together, and how God, by the way, we believe in inspiration, amen, complete inspiration, and we believe in preservation, and we believe God's Word is authoritative. We believe it's forever settled in heaven. We believe it's written by the very breath of God. It's a supernatural book, amen. And I know you'll not hear that everywhere, but this is a supernatural book. And in the composition of this book, 66 books in entirety, Old Testament, New Testament, there are four letters, four epistles. And the epistle is not an apostle's wife, amen. The epistle is a New Testament letter. Now, when I got saved, I didn't know what an epistle was, didn't know what an apostle was, didn't know what songs were, didn't know what tithing was. Hey, but I'm glad I found out about all that. But in the New Testament, there are four epistles that are known, listen now, as the prison epistles, the prison epistles. They are the book of Ephesians, also the book of Philippians, and then the book of Colossians, and fourthly, the book of Philemon. We call them, Brother Finley, you know this, we call them prison epistles because they were written by the Apostle Paul while he was incarcerated as a prisoner of Rome, all right? A prisoner of Rome. But let me hurry up and say something right here. Before he admitted to being a prisoner of Rome, you know what he admitted before that? He said, I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ. I wish we could look at our circumstances a little different. I wish I had somebody. I said, I wish sometimes that we could look at our circumstances as God sees them. Here's Paul in a Roman dungeon. Here's Paul, a Roman prisoner. Here's Paul locked up by Roman authorities. But it didn't bother him, Brother Andy. He said, my bonds in Christ are made manifest in all the palace. You know what else he said? He said, I want to send greetings and salutation even from those of Caesar's household. What's that mean? He wants some of that crowd to God. He wants some of that crowd to God. Philemon is a prison epistle, and Philemon was one to Christ by Paul sent back to Onesimus, amen. Onesimus sent back to Philemon. What a great day. What a great day in all of our lives when we quit looking at all the negativity about our own situation and realize, hold on, that we might just be in the perfect will of God. I wish I had a Bible reader. God, help us to quit all this complaining. God, help us to quit all this belly aching. God, help us to quit all this quitting and giving up and throwing in the towel and backing up on our commitments and our loyalty when things don't go our way. I want to tell you tonight that things wasn't going Paul's way, but Paul said, I'm not a prisoner of Rome. I'm not a prisoner of Caesar. I'm not a prisoner of the Imperial Guard. I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ. I am in bonds. I'm in bonds tonight because I am right in the center of the perfect will of God, serving God. And because he was a prisoner of Rome, because he was a prisoner of Jesus Christ, he was able to spread the gospel to that city of Rome. Listen now, listen, please listen, okay? It's all introduction. Be a happy, happy day in your Christian life. It'd be a really good day in your Christian life. And I'll tell you, it'll be a peaceful day in your Christian life when you realize that adverse circumstances are not the end of the road. that the bend in the road, that the bend in the road, thank God, Brother Wofford, it's not the end of the road. God help us. I feel under conviction. How about you? God help us. Brother Mac, we want to change our circumstances. We want to alter them. We want to second guess them. We want to complain about them. We want to doubt them. We want to throw up our hands in despair. Some of you here tonight, oh God, your circumstances has weighed heavy on you. I mean, they've taken a toll on you. But have you ever realized that in back of it all is the sovereign God of the universe? And that sovereign God is still in control. We've preached it all of our life. We've preached and sung. We've shouted about it, that there's no accidents with God, that nothing catches God off guard. Oh, friend, please listen tonight. Please listen. And I don't know what kind of adverse circumstances that I'm going to face in the next year of my life or even the next 6 months of my life. But I know one thing. When I look at the Apostle Paul, he went through those adverse circumstances and was led, Brother Derek, by the Holy Spirit to write 4 books of our Bible. I feel like running, amen? I said I feel like running, amen? He wrote 4 books of our Bible while he was in jail, amen? I said while he was in jail, the bread may not have been that well, the water might have been tainted, the guards might have been mean, the chains might have hurt, the darkness might have affected his eyes. Are y'all listening tonight? The little rats might have been scurrying around, but you know what? God came to him. I said God came to him and gave him by divine inspiration 4 epistles of the New Testament, and those epistles are forever settled in heaven, and they've been a help to our life and a help to the church of the living God. I'm simply trying to say tonight that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. I'm here to tell you tonight that God is in control in the midst of your terrible situation. Hallelujah goes right there. We got to believe it. We have to believe it. We have to exercise faith. We must trust God. We must look at it that way. Because if you don't look at it that way, you're going to get under the cloud and under the gloom, none of the fretfulness of your own adverse circumstances. All right? So thank God. Thank God for 4 prison epistles. Thank God. Now I want you to go to one of them, and that's Philippians chapter 1. I'm going to show you these verses, and you're not going to believe it hardly, that a man could write it while he's in jail. By the way, I have a title. You know what my title is tonight? The Prison Pulpit. Amen. The Prison Pulpit. He's going to use the prison for his pulpit. Look what he said to the Philippian church. He's in Rome, incarcerated, by the way, probably shackled to some of Rome's imperial guard. The Praetorian Guard's the word. Amen. I've studied this. It's shackled, Brother Pye, to the Praetorian Guard. That changes every 4 to 6 hours. And they change over and over. And so he's shackled to them. But look what he says to this church in the book, in the city of Philippi, chapter 1 and verse number 27. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. I want to stop right there and say from the prison pulpit, you know what Paul is saying, telling the church of Philippi? I want you to live. I need to preach now. I want you to live as to be unhindered in this world. Unhindered in this world. Look, if you will, I'm really going to define some terms right here. Let your conversation, your manner of life, your daily deportment, your daily manner of living. Don't take a bathroom break. Stay with me, all right? Your daily manner of living. It also has the connotation of your heavenly citizenship. And what he's saying there is our heavenly citizenship should take priority over our earthly citizenship, and we should live as preaching time, okay? We should live a life that is becoming, that is honorable that is suitable, that adorns the doctrine of God, that magnifies the gospel. It doesn't bring shame on the gospel. It doesn't bring disgrace on the gospel. It doesn't bring disgrace on Christianity. I tell you, it's lip service is cheap. I said lip service is cheap. God's not looking for lip service. We've got a lot of people that have a lot of lip service, but God is saying in this verse right here, it's time to have some life service. It's time to live the gospel. It's time to walk the gospel. It's time to have a conduct. It's time to have a behavior. It's time to have a lifestyle, a heavenly citizenship while you're on earth that is becoming to the gospel of Christ. Remember what I said now. He's writing this from jail. Amen. He's writing this from jail. But I tell you what, I'm having a fit with cufflinks anymore. I'm going to give up on them, all right? Look at verse 27 to the Philippian church. Only let your conversation, your manner of life, be as it becometh. That word means that it is appropriate after a godly sort, that which is worthy, that which is suitable, that which draws praise to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I want to say to this church tonight, your life, and my life can either accent and adorn the gospel of God, or we can bring shame and disgrace because of the daily life that we live. Now, I tell you, a lot of folks are throwing in the towel about this right here, and they think it doesn't matter. Let's just fit in. Let's just blend in. Let's just accept everything. Let's do everything. Let's enjoy everything. Let's be everything. Let's not be different. Let's not stand out. Let's not be separated. Let's not be consecrated. Let's not be different. Let's not shine as light. Let's not be salt of the earth. How are you going to win anybody if you're light and if you're salt? Let's just blend in. Live like everybody else is living. I got news for you tonight. That is not what Paul said. That is not what Paul said. Paul said, I want you to live the gospel. I want your conversation, your daily deportment, your daily lifestyle to be a reflection and to bring glory and to bring honor upon the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, there are too many people. Are y'all going to help me tonight or not? You can leave me up here by myself. I'm trying the best I can. There are too many people that are bringing shame and disgrace on the name of Christ, on the church of God, on the gospel of Christ, on the Bible, on Christianity, because what they say is not supported in the way they live. And if how you live doesn't support what you say, and you are a contradiction, and I say to you tonight, it's time for saints to be saints. Amen. I'm serious. I love you, and I'm not angry. I'm not upset. I'm not bothered, but I am not accepting everything. I'm not doing everything. I don't want to fit in. I don't want to blend in. Do I look like a chameleon? I'm not a chameleon. I'm not changing colors with the crowd I'm with. Amen. Hold on, sweetheart. Hold on tonight. I'm not changing colors with the crowd I'm with. I'd like to be one thing on Sunday. I'd like for us to be one thing on Monday, or the same thing on Sunday. Excuse me, let me get it right. I'd like for us to be the same thing on Monday that we are on Sunday. And we ought to be the same thing on Friday night and Saturday night as we are on Sunday. I'm preaching one verse tonight, and Brother Galloway, what he's saying is, I want the Philippian church, by the way, I'm down here in jail writing this. I'm not feeling sorry for myself. I'm not quitting. I'm not giving up my class. I'm not quitting the choir. I'm not getting out of Sunday school. I'm not getting out of Wednesday night. I'm not getting out of Sunday night. I'm not going to quit tithing. I'm not going to quit going to youth function. I'm not going to quit going to old-fashioned camp meeting. I'm in jail. I'm in jail, but there's joy in my heart. There's victory in my soul. There's a shout in my voice. And I want to say to the church at Philippi, I'm over here in Rhodes. You're over there in Philippi. And it's time that God's people live the gospel. God help us. We've got too much compromise going on. We've got too much worldliness going on. We've got too much carnality going on. Social media has destroyed us. Don't negate it. Don't negate it. Don't negate it. Social media has destroyed us. Social media hadn't helped the church. Social media hadn't helped Christianity. Social media hadn't helped some of your testimonies. Matter of fact, it's marred your testimony. You look at social media and you say, they're doing that. They're looking like that. They're being that sensual. They're being that worldly. They're being that appealing. What are they doing? What are they doing? What are they doing? What are they doing living that way? Isn't anybody want to be a Christian? Don't nobody want to be godly? Don't nobody want to be holy? Don't nobody want to be shine as lights in the world? Don't nobody want to be salt anymore? Don't we want to be a light, not under a bushel, but a light on a hill? Oh, friend tonight, listen, friend. Don't you accept the devil's lie. Don't you listen to the devil's lie. There is nothing wrong with God's people being distinct. Amen. I'm telling you now, nothing wrong with God's people being distinct. You young people, I think sometimes you get up in the morning. Here's what you do. I think you young people get up, and I think some of you, not all of you. I think some of you young people get up in the morning, wet your finger. I shouldn't have done that. I about got stuck. Wet your finger, put it up, and see which way the wind's blowing. See what's accepted. What's accepted? Where's that in the Bible? Where's that in whole time Holy Ghost living? Where's that in holiness? Where's that in godly living? What are we trying to train up around here? What are we trying to produce around here? What do we want out of our kids? What do we want of our grandchildren? So, well, I just want them to be successful. I just want them to be popular. I just want them to be accepted. I just want them to fit in. You mean fit in like I got to drink like everybody else? Fit in like they got to smoke tobacco like everybody else? Fit in like you got to have chaw in your mouth like everybody else? Fit in like you got to be sensual on social media and show your cleavage like everybody else? That's what you're talking about? That's what you're talking about? Fit in? That's what you want? Is that what you want? That's what you want to raise? No. Can I tell you something about reconcile that with this one verse I'm preaching. Reconcile that with verse 27. Look at it. Only, I like that word only, Brother Finley. Only let your conversation, your manner of life, your lifestyle, your heavenly citizenship, it should take precedence over your earthly citizenship. Be as it becometh the what? The gospel of Christ. That word becometh means suitable or appropriate. It should be, listen, here's the term. Your life, my life, all of our lives should adorn the doctrine of God. It should adorn the doctrine, not take away from the doctrine. Listen, I've been doing this a long time. I've been preaching since I was 18. Am I 61, Lynn? Am I 61? Somebody do the math on that. How many? 43 years. I'm trying to preach that book right there. 43 years trying to exhort people. Encourage, and you know it's the truth. And do it in love. Do it in love. You know what the leadership of the church wants? You know what the leadership of the school wants? We just want young people, boys and girls. We just want them to turn out right. Is that too much to ask? We just want them to turn out right. Yes, we want them to have a good, yes, we want them to get a good education. Yes, we sure do. But we just want them to turn out right and just perpetuate old time religion and live for Jesus, live for Jesus. I don't want drinkers. I don't want cussers. I don't want nakedness. I don't want pot smokers. I don't want cigarette smokers. I don't want bud dummers and middle low life and harlotry and promiscuity and sexual permissiveness. And no, that's not what we're after. That's not what we're after. We're after some young ladies and some young men that want to come through school and come through the youth choir and forever live for Jesus, forever be different, forever be a Christian, and by the way, and marry in the will of God. I want to say something right there. Just because he goes to church, and just because she goes to church, and just because they go to Christian school, and just because they sing in the youth choir, and just because they're in Sunday school, don't you take nothing for granted, dear friend. There's a lot of stage actors out there. I said there's a lot of stage actors out there. Somebody ought to be doing some interviewing. Somebody ought to be hearing some testimony. Somebody ought to find out, are you saved by the grace of God? Do you have a heart for God? Do you want to live for Jesus? You're going to date my daughter. You're going to date my son. What kind of life do you live? Amen. Amen. I haven't even skimmed the surface tonight. Amen. I haven't even skimmed the surface tonight. Amen. Oh my. Why am I? Paul writing from a jail cell, and I'm preaching on the prison pulpit. He said, I want you to be unhindered in this world. To be unhindered in this world. Why, please tell me, why do we have to let the world dictate for us how we're supposed to be? When I thought it was supposed to be completely opposite. We're not supposed to let the world put us in its mold. Amen. I want to say another word tonight, and I know some of you parents may take offense, and I don't want you to take offense. You're going to do wrong. I told my wife before we came to church tonight, I named a family. Some of them are here. The mom and dad's not here tonight, but I named a family, and I said, you know what? I said, I guarantee you that crowd's never talked about God's men. I bet they've never talked about God's men. They've never ran God's men down. I said, now their grown daughters are in church. Their grown daughters want to serve God. Their grown daughters want to do the will of God. Friend, you'll get yourself in a whole heap of trouble by tearing down the men of God. You know, here's what I thought about. Because when you tear down the men of God, it puts in them kids' mind, well, if mom and daddy don't believe in the old goat, if mom and daddy don't have no confidence in the old goat, why should I have any confidence in the old goat? And I'm telling you tonight, you tear down God's, and I'm talking about me, I'm talking about all of them. You tear down God's men in front of your kids, you are doing irreparable damage to their young mind. Irreparable damage. I don't want you to take offense. I'm not here to get anybody upset. I'm not here to get anybody mad. My heart's broke tonight of what I'm seeing. I want to plead with our teenagers. I want to plead with our young adults. I want to plead with these young girls and these young boys. You don't have to advertise yourself on social media and push yourself. God loves you like you are. God loves you like you are. And if somebody's going to accept you because of what you put on social media, and by the way, what you win them with is what you're going to have to keep them with. If that's what you're going to have to do to keep them, and earlier I said show your cleavage, and I meant it, and I'm not taking it back, but if that's how you got to win that boy, that's how you'll have to keep that boy, and he'll be looking at somebody else. Amen. I'm not nary a bit in favor of it. Say amen. Somebody say amen to the preacher. Trying to help the teenagers. Trying to rescue the young boys and the young girls. We don't want you to marry out of the will of God. We want you to find out if that boy's saved. We want you to find out if that girl's saved. Find out if they smoke dope. Find out if they drink a little liquor. You say, well, what's wrong with that? Well, come on, where are you? What planet you on? I grew up with liquor. I grew up with it. It destroyed our family. It destroyed our family. How many be honest tonight? Help me tonight. How many be honest? You say, raise your hand. I mean, how many be honest? It hurt my family too. Raise your hand. Look at that. Look at that. Look, look, look. Oh, God. Oh, God. Young lady, that's not acceptable. Young man, that's not acceptable. It's not. I don't care how popular he is. How much, I don't know who I'm talking to. I don't care how much money he has. I don't care how good looking he is. I don't care what kind of car he drives. I don't care what he looks like on social media. Anybody can put a wife beater on and flex your muscles and look bad, big and bad. Is a wife beater, is that one of them t-shirts? Is that a t-shirt? Yeah, yeah. I got one on right now, but I ain't going to show you it, amen. No, my God, the building was empty. Say amen. Don't say amen, Lynn. The building would look at it. Oh, I'm going to pop you. I'm going to pop you. No, I'm not going to pop you. I'm not going to pop you. You know the building was empty. She told me the other day, she said something about, I'll tell you now, them legs of yours, they look like fluorescent bulbs. I said, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. That's okay. It's okay. Now I'm going to stop right there. Lord God. A little bit of fun. Listen, it's not about looks, young lady. Young man, it's not about looks. It's not about looks. Not about money. It's not about his family pedigree. Not about what college he's from. What sport he plays. What sport he plays, how good looking she is. And there's some wonderfully good looking ladies in this world and young ladies and even in this church. I mean, I don't mean this bad. Some very pretty young ladies in this church, but there's more to it. Favor is deceitful. Beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. I'm going to call on you parents tonight to get some testimonies from who they're dating. Get some interviews. Say, well, he ain't got time. Well, you better find time. You better take him out there to the Burger King all by yourself. Say, look me right in my eyeball, son. Look me in my eyeball. I want to hear your testimony. When did you get saved? Are you saved? Are you a Baptist? Say amen. Yeah. Do you tithe your income? Say amen. I knew they'd get quiet. Amen. All this stuff's important. Important. Find, for the love of God, for the love of God, find out who your kids are associating with. Find out who your kids are interested in. You have to. It's your job, sir. It's your job, ma'am. It's your job. I'm tired of seeing young ladies and young men grow up and turn their back on everything that we've all tried to put in them. I'm tired of that. I don't want to see no more of that. I don't want to, you know what? Look up here. I'm just preaching tonight. I'm pastoring right now. I'm pastoring. Can I pastor? Will you let me pastor the church? You know what you're supposed to do after the youth choir? Look up here. You know what you're supposed to do after the youth choir? You graduate to the adult choir. You just keep going. You just keep going. You know what you do when you get married and have two or three of them youngins? You bring them to Sunday school like your mom and daddy brought you to Sunday school. You bring them to Sunday school like your mom and daddy brought you to Sunday school. If I'm lying, I'm dying. Stand up, Derek. Stand up, Philip. I'm not sure what, that's my two sons. Stand up, Bethany. Stand up, Tiffany. They're my two daughters. I think it was you. I think it was this one. Old soft stomach. I believe it's that. And it was about Sunday school time. I don't feel good. I don't feel so well. And we was all, whole crowd, unloaded up, about dressed. You know, I don't feel so well. You know what I told him? I said, go stick your finger down your throat. Go ahead and get it over with. It's coming, it's coming, it's coming. The tsunami's coming. You might as well head it off. Stick a high and go ahead and get out what's all in there. I know some of you don't agree with that. And just get it over with. And because you know what? At 10 o'clock, we all go to the same place. At 11 o'clock, we go to the same place. At 7 p.m. that night, we go to the same place. Oh, wait a minute. No baseball, no Little League, no swim meet. No. At Wednesday night, we go, not even practice. At Wednesday night, we go to the same place. That's how that crowd was brought up. Guess what? Guess where they're at right now tonight? Oh, God. I just let a happy bubble out. Say amen. They're in the same place they've been brought up with the whole life. Train up a child in the way he should go when he's old and not depart from it. Stay with it, son. Stay with it, son. Stay with it, daughter. Stay with it, daughter. God bless you. You may be seated. Now, if it's a grand young'un, I don't feel good, Poppy. I said, well, Poppy, stay home with you tonight. You know that's right. Lynn, you go on, Lynn. I'll keep him. I'll baby him. You know that's about par for the course. No, I ain't gonna tell them grand young'un to stick the finger down the throat. No, because you know why? I don't want it all over me. Say amen. That only happened once. Let me ask you something, young lady. What do you want in life?
Yeah.
What do you want in life? Let me ask some of you young men something. What do you want in life?
Right.
What are you after? Six figures? You probably won't ever get that. But if you do, fine. Just make sure you tithe.
Yeah. Right.
Matter of fact, if you get to six figures, you give 20%. Amen.
Good.
Amen. Somebody help me. You give 20%. We'll still love you. We'll love you. We'll love you to death. Amen. I'm just cutting up a little bit. What do you want? What do you want for your kids? Have you had a conversation with that young man yet? Have you had a conversation with that young lady yet? Do you even know who they're spending the night with?
Come on.
Do you know anything about their home and their family? Do you know what goes on in that home? Do you? We've had kids get in trouble. Because of who they spent the night with. And it could have been that if they wouldn't have spent the night, they wouldn't have gotten in trouble.
Right. Right.
Yep. You can't be too careful.
Right.
Could I tell you this? I'm going to move on. I'm going to say this to all the parents. All the parents, look at me. We only have one chance.
You're right.
We only have one chance. 18, 17, 18. They've done pretty much grown up by then.
Yes, sir.
Got them on their own. And that's okay. That's the way it's supposed to be. And by the way, there's such a thing as cutting the apron strings. Amen?
Yep.
Let them grow up. Start trusting them.
Right.
But for 16, 17 years of their life, I think I need to be there. And I think Mama needs to be there every step of the way.
Yep. Yep.
Every step of the way. They need guidance. They need prayer. God knows they need love. I was at a person's house. I won't name him. I was at a person's house. I left that house the other day and told my wife, I said, so wonderful to see parents hug their children, love their children, put their arms around their daughter, their grown daughters and their grown sons. Tickles me to death. Now, why do you get quiet on that? He said, well, my mama never showed me no affection. That's all the more reason why you ought to show affection. Well, my daddy never told me he loved me. Well, he's a dumb daddy. Say amen. That's right. He's a dumb daddy. You ought not to be a dumb daddy. You ought to tell your son you love him. Be time. Say amen. The prison pulpit. Paul said, I want you to be unhindered in the world. Look at verse 27. He said in verse 27, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. He said, not only do I want you to be unhindered in the world, but I want you to be undivided in the church. I want you to be undivided in the church. I can't preach all this tonight. I've already preached what I felt like I needed to preach. I want you to be undivided in the church. Stand fast in one spirit. Look at verse number 27. Look at the word one spirit. Brother Finley, one spirit, one mind. Sounds like unity to me. I want you to be not only be unhindered in the world, Miss Love, Dr. Love, but I want you to be undivided in the church. Undivided in the church. You know, listen to this, man. You'll love this. Now, I'm not this smart. But Adam, I'm not this smart, but man, whoever said this is smart. I'm not this smart, but this man's smart. You ready? You ready? The things that unite us are far more important than any personality clashes that may divide us. The things that unite us are far more important than any personality clashes that may divide us. And by the way, since we be brethren, there ought really not to be no personality clashes. We ought to learn to be in unity and love one another. Amen. He said this prison pulpit, he said, I want you to be unhindered in the world. I want you to be undivided in the church, but I want you to be unafraid in your heart. Look at verse 28 through 30. I'm going to preach this one day, not tonight. And in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is them in evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation and that of God. For unto you, Lord, look at this verse. I'm not going to preach it right now. For unto you it is given in the name and behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me. That's Acts 16, Philippians jail, in the Philippian jail. And now here to be me, that's Rome. He said, I want you to be unafraid in your hearts. I want you to be unafraid in your hearts. But you know what? That's a whole other outline, a whole other message. I feel like tonight that probably every one of us ought to get down here. We ought to pray for every teenager we know. We ought to pray for every 8 and 10 year old we know. Tiffany's coming to the piano, or Jade, or somebody. God knows we ought to start praying. We ought to keep praying for our grandchildren. Lord, what hope do they have? What hope do they have in this wicked, ungodly, loathsome world? By the way, the radical left agenda is getting more left as the clock ticks by the hour. It's getting worse, radically left, more than you've ever seen in your life. And any semblance of Christianity is going to be pushed right out the door. I mean, right out the door. That's all the more reason. That's all the more reason. We need to double down, buckle down, hunker down, get serious with God. I'm talking about weeping. I'm talking about crying. I'm talking about praying. I'm talking about calling your children's name, calling your grandchildren's name. I'm talking about interceding for the teenagers of this church, interceding for the college and career, praying for all of these kids in this youth choir. We have to produce a generation that wants to serve God. We have to. We have to. How important is your child's future? How important is it that your grandchildren get saved at an early age and grow up and love and enjoy church just like you've enjoyed church? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God help us tonight, Lord, to do what Paul said in this prison pulpit. Lord, to have our conversation, our lifestyle, our conduct, our behavior, our heavenly citizenship, be as it becometh, it adorns the gospel of Christ. God, there's several in the altar and there's several more ought to come. I pray you'll prick hearts right now. I pray you'll touch hearts in this service tonight. It's so early. Lord, it's probably too early to even go home. God, prick hearts tonight. I'd like to see some teenagers come talk to God. Lord, some young ladies talk to God about their life, some moms and dads, some grandparents. I pray they would. I pray we'd get more serious than we've ever been. I mean, get more serious than we've ever been about being concerned about our young people's future. Bless the invitation in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing.
Seven.
Sing it.